Hello students, we are going to discuss benign epithelial lesions of breast. These lesions, they are divided into three groups according to the risk of developing breast cancers. First is non-proliferative breast changes, which has risk of 1% going into invasive carcinoma breast. Then proliferative breast diseases with risk 1.5 to 2%, and third is atypical hyperplasias. So first category is non-proliferative breast changes or breast lesions, which include fibrocystic changes. Fibrocystic changes, to the clinician, it is lumpy bumpy breast on palpations, and to radiologist, a dense breast with cysts, and to a pathologist, it is benign histologic finding. These lesions are termed non-proliferative to distinguish them from proliferative changes, which are associated with increased risk of breast cancer than non-proliferative breast changes. So, fibrocystic disease. There are three morphological changes in fibrocystic disease. First is cystic change, then fibrosis and adenosis. Small cysts are formed by the dilation and unfolding of lobules, and in turn they may coalesce to form larger cysts. Unopened cysts, they contain turbid semi-translucent fluid that produces a brown or blue color, known as blue dome cysts. The cysts are lined by either flattened atrophic epithelium or by metaplastic apocrine cells. These apocrine cells, they have abundant granular eosinophilic cytoplasm, round nuclei, and they closely resemble normal apocrine epithelium of sweat glands. So, the cysts, dilated cysts, they are lined by apocrine cells. On mammography, calcifications are seen. Milk of calcium is a term mammographers used to describe the calcifications that line the bottom of rounded cyst. The cysts, when they are solitary and firm to palpation, they are alarming. The diagnosis is confirmed by disappearance of the cyst after fine needle aspiration of its content. Second component is fibrosis. When cysts rupture, they release secretory material into the adjacent stroma, resulting into chronic inflammation and fibrosis that will lead to palpable firmness of the breast. Third component of fibrocystic disease is adenosis. Adenosis is defined as increase in number of acini per lobule. It is a normal physiologic process during the pregnancy. While in non-pregnant women, adenosis can occur as a focal change. The acini are often enlarged but are not distorted, as seen in sclerosing adenosis. So the acini are enlarged. Calcification may be present within the lumens. The acini that are enlarged, they are lined by columnar cells, which may appear benign or show some atypical features, that is known as flat epithelial atypia. The lesions may be earliest recognizable precursor of epithelial neoplasia. In addition to fibrocystic disease, there is another entity, lactational adenomas. It is present as palpable mass in pregnant and lactating women. These are formed by normal appearing breast tissue with physiologic adenosis and lactational changes. These lesions are not true neoplasms, but an exaggerated focal response to hormonal influences. The next category, proliferative breast disease without atypia. These changes are commonly detected as mammographic densities, calcifications, or incidental finding in specimen from biopsies performed for other reasons. So, proliferative breast disease without ATPR, they can be seen incidentally or detected by mammographic densities. Although each can be found in isolation, typically more than one lesion is present. So, they are frequent in association with non-proliferative breast changes. These lesions are characterized by proliferation of ductal epithelial or stroma without cytologic or architectural features suggestive of carcinoma in situ. Proliferative breast disease without ATPR, it has one entity, epithelial hyperplasias. The normal breast ducts and lobules, they have double layered lining of columnar cells, luminal cells that are columnar, and the myoepithelial cells. When epithelial hyperplasia is defined by presence of more than two cell layers, the additional cells consist of both luminal as well as myoepithelial cells that will fill and distend the ducts and lobules. So, when number of cells, number of lining is increased, and it will distend the duct and lobules, it is epithelial hyperplasia. So, this microphotograph is normal histology showing double layered duct, and this is hyperplasia, epithelial hyperplasia. Irregular lumens are often discerned at the periphery of the cellular masses. So, epithelial cells, there is increase in epithelial cells and myoepithelial cells that will obliterate the lumen, but with presence of some lumens, slit-like spaces, they are seen at the periphery. Epithelial hyperplasia is usually an incidental finding. Second is sclerosing adenosis. The number of acini per terminal duct is increased to at least double the number found in uninvolved lobules. The normal lobular arrangement is maintained in sclerosing adenosis. Acini are compressed and distorted in the central portion of the lesions, but they are dilated at the periphery. Myoepithelial cells are prominent. On occasion, stromal fibrosis may completely compress the lumens to create the appearance of solid cords or double strands of cells lying within dense stroma. This histologic pattern at times closely mimics the appearance of invasive carcinoma due to presence of cords. This is microphotograph showing the involved terminal duct lobular unit that is enlarged. Enlarged lobular terminal duct lobular unit, the acini are compressed and distorted by dense stroma, and the acini at periphery, they are dilated and compressed in the center. Outer border is well circumscribed. Now, the complex sclerosing lesions, they have component sclerosing adenosis with papillomas and epithelial hyperplasia. It includes radial scar or radial sclerosing lesion. It form irregular masses and closely mimic invasive carcinoma more mammographically, grossly, and histologically. So, radial scar is mimicker of carcinoma, In radial scar, there is presence of central nidus of entrapped glands in a hyalinized stroma with long radiating projections into the stroma. It is a misnomer as these lesions are not associated with prior trauma or surgery. So, radial sclerosing lesion or radial scar, first photograph is mammographic, which show central mass, irregular mass, radiodense projection with projections. This is the gross appearance. Here you can see irregular mass, and this is the micro photograph, which is showing central nidus of small tubules. These are small tubules. They are in fibrotic stroma, and numerous projections you can see like infiltration seen in carcinoma. So, it is close mimicker of carcinoma breast. Another entity is papilloma. Papillomas are composed of multiple branching fibrovascular cores, each having a connective tissue axis lined by luminal and myoepithelial cells. Growth occurs within a dilated duct. So, it is seen in duct. Epithelial hyperplasia and apocrine metaplasia, they may be present. Large duct papillomas are usually solitary and situated in lactiferous sinuses of the nipple, and small duct papillomas, they are multiple and located deeper within the ductular system. Large duct papillomas are solitary while small ducts are multiple. So this is the microphotograph of intraductal papilloma. As you can see, this is a duct with a central fibrovascular core that extends from the wall of the duct. These are papillae arborization of the papillae within the lumen, and these are lined by myoepithelial cells and luminal cells. More than 80% of large duct papillomas, they produce nipple discharge, that is, and that too is bloody discharge due to infarction of the papillomas. Non-bloody discharge probably results from intermittent blockage and release of normal breast secretions. The remaining large duct papillomas and most small duct papillomas come to clinical attention as small palpable masses or densities and calcification seen on mammograms. So, papillomas, they present as bloody discharge or non-bloody discharge and palpable masses. Proliferative breast diseases with atypia. It includes atypical ductal hyperplasia and atypical lobular hyperplasia. Atypical hyperplasia is a cellular proliferation resembling carcinoma in situ, but they lack sufficient qualitative or quantitative features for diagnosis as carcinoma. Atypical ductal hyperplasia is recognized by its histologic resemblance to ductal carcinoma in situ. It consists of relatively monomorphic proliferation of regularly spaced cells, and it is distinguished from DCIS by being limited in extent and only partially filling the ducts. So, atypical ductal hyperplasia, it has limited extent and partially fill the ducts. So, this is the microphotograph of atypical ductal hyperplasia. In this, a duct is filled with mixed population of cells consisting of columnar cells that is oriented towards the periphery and round cells in the center. Although some of the spaces are round and regular, these are round spaces, but towards the periphery, these are irregular slit-like spaces. Atypical lobular hyperplasia, it is defined as proliferation of cells identical to those of lobular carcinoma in situ, but cells do not fill or extend more than 50% of the acini within a lobule. Microphotograph of atypical lobular hyperplasia showing monomorphic small round loosely cohesive cells partially filling the lobule. Thank you.